We are going to talk about how Marx converted what was purely economic. And let me remind you, what we are trying to discuss here is this. A general impression, or a common sense, if I should say, of mainstream social sciences, which are ideologies of various kinds, is that in Marxism, everything is reduced to economics, which is called economic reductionism. Okay, so just to keep track of what we are doing, this is the problem we are still discussing. And what we are going to discuss today, that actually this is just the opposite. This is just the opposite of what Marxism is. Marxism is not only economic, it is not that it's not economic reductionism, rather what was purely economic in classical political economy, purely economic belongs to classical political economy.
Some of you, those who are sitting this side,
can look at that. At least for the text.
Some of you, those who can go closer to that side, and those who can see it here.
So some, actually, some courses we have many students, so you can have them both sides. It'll be nice.
I'm just talking. So I think we should have planned that.
Is it a touchscreen thing, this one?
Okay. Now, there are three sources of Marxism, and these three sources are also the three main component parts of Marxism. From each source, Marx borrowed one important component or part. So, from German ideology, and what he does, that he borrows something and he rejects something. And so what he borrows and what he rejects, there is a logic for that. So for instance, the first element is dialectics. And the idea of dialectics, Marx borrowed from Hegel, who was a philosopher. It was part of German philosophy. So from the German philosophy, he takes the idea of dialectics. But in German philosophy, the dialectics was ideal, means it was the dialectics of ideas, thesis, antithesis, and then synthesis. That the change and system, everything was reduced to ideas. The primacy of ideas, that was dialectical idealism. Marx takes the principle of dialectics, but rejects the idea of idealism. So rejecting idealism but keeping dialectics. So the first component part of Marxism is dialectical. Okay, that's what we discussed last time. The second part and the second source. So the first source is German philosophy. From German philosophy he takes the idea of dialectics. Okay, and combines it with materialism. So second part, and this is the second part which is very, very interesting, that is classical political economy. So what does Marx take from classical political economy and what does he reject? It is here, actually that is the main part and perhaps the most important part that we have to understand. What does Marx take from political economy and what he rejects and why? Why he takes the part that he takes and why he rejects the part that he rejects? So, just as philosophy was most developed in Germany, and from Germany or from German philosophy, he takes the idea of dialectics from German philosophy. Similarly, classical political economy was most developed in England. So, in England, particularly David Ricardo, Adam Smith, and James Mill, this is the holy trinity of classical political economy. So, from English classical political economy, Marx borrows the idea of value. And the meaning of value is, in order to understand the meaning of value, once again, I want to remind you that what we are discussing here is the development of capitalism. And to understand the origin and the internal dynamics, what is the main characteristic, what characterizes capitalism, what distinguishes capitalism from feudalism? Because as we are going to read later on, capitalism develops on the ruins of feudalism. So what distinguishes capitalism from feudalism? And actually, I want to remind you once again that in Marxism, change from one system to another, and let me just say it once again and write it down for you, that change from one system to another in Marxism or the distinction between two different systems is most importantly, it is based on now, if you know the meaning of social relations of production. Yeah, any question? Okay. Speaker? Not working? Oh, I see. Okay. Now, that change from one system to another is basically, most importantly, it is the change in social relations of production. Change in social relations of production is accompanied by change in political structure and the normative structure, values, ideas, and all those things, that political structure, juridical structure, and values. If you see feudal society and the norms that govern feudal society, they were very different, fundamentally different, from the norms and values of capitalist society. And clue to that lies in social relations of production that characterize capitalist mode of production. So now, what is capitalist mode of production? What is most important thing? What is capitalism for? What is the main objective of capitalism? And profit, how do they make profit? Yes, I agree with you. You are a little bit ahead of me. Yeah, you are a little bit ahead of me. What is the objective of capitalist production? I agree with you. And how do they acquire surplus value? Yes, they exploit this labor. That's fine. That's why I'm saying you are one step ahead of me. Again, you are going still further.
Okay.
Capitalism is Okay. Capitalism is a system of commodity production. Commodity is something for sale. Commodity is something for sale. And here is the difference between capitalism and feudalism. Feudal economy, sale was not the prime objective. The prime objective of feudal economy was direct consumption. But in feudalism, everything is commodity, including the labor itself. And later on, you will read, while talking about Max Weber and Marx, is Max Weber's whole definition of class is very different, because labor in feudalism, labor in antiquity was not for sale, was not for sale. So yes, peasant in feudalism was not free. Peasant in feudalism was also exploited, but peasant could not sell labor in free market. And that free market is, of course, we'll talk about that, how free is free market, how free is labor, that's a different problem. But the most important difference was that labor was not a commodity. In capitalism, labor itself becomes a commodity. So that's where that everything in capitalism is for sale. That this is a system where everything is for sale. What makes this possible is new social relation of production, in which labor itself is converted into a commodity. How that process takes place, what that process is, we will discuss that while talking about the origin of capitalism and seeing two different views, one given by Max Weber, the other given by Marx, about how capitalism originates, what created capitalism, and what's the break-off point between capitalism and feudalism. So we'll come to that later. What is important here in order to understand the surplus value, which is the point you are making, is that capitalism is a system of commodity production where everything is for sale. Okay. And it is in this process that profit is made. It is in this process of sale and purchase that profit is made. Now, the whole theory of profit, yes, capitalism is a system for profit. Okay. The most important question here is, what is the source of profit?
Labor.
Okay. How is labor source of profit? How is the labor source of profit?
Because you extract surplus labor, you they work extra hours, extra hours, and basically.
Okay, entirely correct, and this idea was totally absent before Karl Marx. In classical political economy, the profit was the entrepreneurship and rationality. Profit was being created by capital. In classical political economy, profit was being created by capital and capitalists. The main source of profit was capital. Yeah, and actually that's one of the problems that we are going to talk about. What created capitalism? Is it the initial capital? The whole idea is debunked by Marx once again. And when you come back to Max Weber, you'll find that he revives the whole idea how in order to develop capitalism you need capital. So here is the problem. Now, whole thing, in order to sell a product, it carries a value. A product carries a value, and it is in terms of value that it is brought into the market and sold. So what was the source of value? So what Marx does here, he accepts or he borrows from classical political economy labor theory of value. Classical political economy agreed that value that a commodity carries is created by labor. That, We are coming to that. Yeah. They were right. Their answer was right. We'll come to that. Okay, here is the thing. Okay, value that a commodity carries is created by labor. But their idea was that labor is compensated for its contribution wages. That labor gets wage and capitalist gets the profit, so it's a free exchange, and it's a rational exchange, because capital buys labor. Capital is free. So is labor. Labor is free to sell its labor, not to sell its labor. Another problem that we'll talk about later on. Now, in this situation, the bargaining between labor and capital, two rational actors working in a free market situation, labor bargains for its wages, and the capitalist bargains for the commodity and value of the commodity. And between the two, there is an equilibrium, there is a balance. There is an equilibrium between what the labor is paid and what the labor is created. And this was exactly the point. So the idea of labor theory of value, Marx accepts it from classical political economy, that yes, value is created by labor. But then what was missing in classical political economy was the idea of surplus value. Now, what is surplus value? Surplus value is the value over and above the necessary . He divides labor into two parts, necessary labor and surplus labor. Necessary labor is what the worker . Here is the point. I may also tell you something, that it took Marx 2 full years. Okay, I repeat this point. Marx devoted 2 full years reading Ricardo's theory of value. That is how seriously he used to take his adversaries. That is how seriously he used to take the work that he did. That after all the maturity, and this was the most mature work that Karl Marx did in his entire life, that he devoted 2 full years reading Ricardo's theory of value. So theory of value that we are talking about is a very difficult notion. It's a very difficult thesis, and I'm the least competent person to discuss that thesis in any serious manner with you. But I'm serious about that. I'm not an economist. I don't understand many things. But there is a sociology of surplus value, and that is what I'm going to talk to you about. So here is something. He agrees with classical political economy, and he borrows from classical political economy. That is the element 2 or component 2, the idea of labor theory of value, that value that a commodity carries. A commodity is for sale. It is sold in terms of value that it has, and the value that it has is created by labor. That's fine. But what was absent again in classical political economy was the idea of surplus value. So the distinction between necessary value and surplus value is this, that If all value is created by labor, then the source of profit is between the necessary labor and the surplus labor. So necessary labor is the wages which are given to the laborer for creating the value. And surplus value, so here is how it works. If the labor creates, suppose it takes 8 hours. He talks about beaver, so you all know the story of beaver in Canada, catching a beaver and skinning it and getting the skin and making those hats and all that, which became very popular in European markets. So suppose it takes 8 hours to create a product, and out of that 8 hours labor to create a value or to create a commodity, the wages that the laborer is paid maybe for 4 hours work, for 4 hours work or 6 hours work, depending on the kind of situation and the position between the labor and capital. And the remaining 4 hours are 2 hours, depending on how much labor is getting and how much capital is trying to save. That remaining hour, if labor is getting the wages for 4 hours of work, it is 8 hours labor to create a commodity. And if the labor is getting wages for 4 hours, then the remaining 4 hours are 2 hours, whatever the situation is, that is surplus labor. That is surplus labor, unpaid labor. Surplus means unpaid. And this unpaid labor is profit. This unpaid labor is profit. So the main source of profit is unpaid labor. Now, what are sociological implications? Here is the sociological implication. In classical political economy, capitalism, whole capitalist system was in capitalism, both labor and capital are commodities, and whole capitalism was defined as a relationship between these two things, labor and commodity. Now, first thing that Marx said, that what appears to be relations between things, that actually relation relations or relationship between things is indeed so it is not relationship between two things, dead objects, two things, but it is relationship between two kinds of human beings, or two classes of human beings who are related to each other through social relations of production. So what exists between labor and capital is not a relationship between two things, but it is a social relation. It is a social relation between two classes of human beings. And the main source of profit lies in this social relationship. So what is the sociology of surplus value? Sociology of surplus value is this. From economics, theology. First,